Her darkest days behind her, Mia revealed to international interviewer Def.
Hi, how you doing, gang? Smile, Jay. Jason, can you look up?
I can't. Yes. Man, it didn't have no animals. Oh, God. I'll be dead by now. You may just hang you upside down.
Jeez.
Yeah. Thank you.
slide up against this wall and take a seat if you'd like. Also, they're 75 caliber. They only shoot 69 caliber musket balls. This allows for the ball to bounce quite erratically out of the barrel, plus for poor flight. These muskets have a range of a quarter of a mile, but they're only accurate to about 100 yards. Now, accuracy to 100 yards is not hitting a fancy bullseye or a knot hole in the side of a tree. It's more or less hitting a rank of men, about 15 men wide and 5 lines deep. And even to hit this, the soldier had to be an excellent aim or a very lucky man. Since the muskets are so inaccurate, they had to depend on hand-to-hand combat and heavier artillery fire to determine most of the battles. At the end of this musket could be attached an 18-inch tri-cornered bayonet, turning the musket into a very effective and deadly 7-foot lance. Also, the butt of the musket is a brass striking plate. It was only used to protect the wood when the musket was set down to be loaded. It's also used an effective club for bashing the skulls of the enemy during hand-to-hand combat. These muskets are so heavy and so long, it could be used for just about any type of hand-to-hand combat fighting utensil you can dream of. The men would be in ranks, as I just described. The first line to be firing, the first line down on their knees. The second line stood up and fired over their heads. After firing, they would shoot to the back of the rank and start to load their muskets. The first man took the hammer, this piece here, and pull it back to the half cock, for safety position. So the safety position. I try to pull the trigger at this time, the hammer will not fly forward. Next, you take the frizzen, this piece here, throw it forward, as opposed to a small priming pan. From the side, you can draw a prepackaged charge they made here at the fore. Take a tube with a musket ball at one end, some black powder at the other end. Bite off the powder end first, pour a small amount of powder in the priming pan. You then close the frizzen, hold the powder in place. Bring his musket to the ground. Pour the remaining amount of powder down the barrel. Crumple up the paper tube around the musket ball, insert it. Draw his ramrod, ram the whole thing down. Now, well-trained trained and efficient soldier can do this within 15 seconds of the previous firing. Well-trained rank, around about 4 times per minute. Obviously, I'm not too well-trained nor efficient, but I will be loading my musket at this time. Doing it in reverse order as I just explained. Putting in the main charge first, priming second. Also here at Lake George, this is a highly populated area. Can't shoot a real musket ball. That was sometimes tempting. So what I'll be doing is inserting this piece of 12-gauge shotgun wadding that will simply disintegrate when I fire my musket. Noise though, you may wish to cover your ears. One, two, three.
It's a fire alarm.
Good firing. Now, as you can see, there's some smoke and debris caused from just one firing. You can imagine 30 guns to rank going off at the same time. It's quite a racket and make the battlefield quite smoky. For this reason, the soldiers cannot communicate verbally. So they had to depend on hand signals. They enhanced their hand signals by wearing brightly colored uniforms. The British would be in the red and white that I'm dressed as. The French would be primarily in the blue and white. Now, one drawback to a brightly colored uniform is that the enemy also can see you. But if a single man was to see another single man to fire upon each other, due to the inaccuracy of these muskets, they probably wouldn't hit each other anyways. Now, are there any questions about the musket or musket firing? If there are no questions, you'd like to see a cannon firing, please follow me to the Northwest Bastion. Assembly line. Every man on the cannon crew had one certain job to perform. He'd step up, do his duty, and step out of the way for the next man. Every man on the cannon crew is also trained for every job. In case one of his comrades had fallen in battle, someone else could take over for him. The first man on the cannon crew would have stepped up with this tool. It's known as the worm. It looks like a giant corkscrew and acts much in the same manner. Insert it down the barrel of the cannon, then twist it around to clear any debris left in the previous firing. They lit in rags, packing.
How could I laugh?
Fort.
Yeah.
Well, I have to apologize. It really wasn't that accurate to an 18th century firing. Imagine, the noise would be quite deafening. The average man in the cannon crew is expected to go deaf within about 6 months to be on active duty. You worry about this or lose much sleep over the fact that though, because he's expected to die within 4 months. Very dangerous working on the cannon crew. After repeated firings in a heavy battle, the breech of the cannon would not be able to keep up the constant pressure. One of the times when the cannon was touched off, rather than those gases expanding and sending the cannonball out, the whole thing would just explode like a giant pipe bomb, therefore killing and at least wounding every man in the cannon crew. Now, are there any questions about the cannon or cannon firing?
How long would it take them to load it?
30 seconds. Any other questions?
What's the distance?
Every cannon had a range of a mile. This one here was only accurate about a quarter of a mile. 12-pound cannons were accurate about a half a mile. Questions, if you'd like to see a musket ball molding demonstration, please follow me down the ramp and across the courtyard. Regulars are very lucky that they didn't mold musket balls, just had their standard issued weapons, and made it very easy for the king to mass produce musket balls and send them over for economically. The colonial or provincial troops, being the colonists here at the time, didn't have a standard issued weapon. Their guns ranged from anywhere from 32 caliber all the way up to 80 caliber. Made it very impossible and impractical. So what he did is the next best thing, he sent over the lead. His lead was the poorest quality, which stuck from the ground and sent over. It still had all the impurities, the rocks, sand, and other minerals within it. These impurities, known as slag or dross, would float to the top of the lead and would have to be taken off the top before molding could begin. I will now be taking the slag off of my lead. They would have had about 2 pounds of slag, every 1 pound of workable metal. Colonists are very angered in this. They came up with a nickname in honor of King George for this lead. They called it pig's lead. As you can see, this was dissension in the ranks even 20 years before the revolution. Now, once a workable surface was obtained, it could begin molding. First mold I'll demonstrate to you is a 63 caliber single shot mold. When open, it looks like two hollowed out halves of a musket ball. Closed, it forms a small pour hole in the top that the lead can be poured in. Very simple advice, the lead is about 700 degrees hotter than this mold. The hot metal touches the cooler metal, it hardens instantly, and sometimes clogs the pour hole before making a musket ball. Soldiers have to dump this out and try again. Now I'll be attempting to mold 163 caliber musket ball. See, it's very shiny and full of luster, not the usual gray color you think of lead being. The reason for this is, it's just in its molten state. All the oxides have been driven off the top. Within about a day or so, this will reoxidize and turn back to the gray color you think of lead being. I've just dunked it in some water so I can touch it with my bare hand. It's finished yet. The Taylor sprue left in that pour hole. This Taylor sprue must be cut off and filed down before the musket ball is loaded. So the loaded in perfect musket ball and try to fire it, likely the gun to blow up in your face and kill him. The other men would say it's not too bad for one man to die from his own stupidity or carelessness. Back then, due to the nature of fighting and closely in ranks, the danger of the man immediately to his left and right. Molding one at a time, they become quite tedious, considering they had to mold about 2,000 with the summer campaign. They came up with this device, gang mold. It's found on Diamond Island, kind of like George, and still works quite fairly today. It's a little more difficult using it though. not only because of its great age, but the core holes are very close together and quite small. So he doesn't like to yield six musket balls. Now attempt to mold six musket balls using this 200-year-old piece. It has had time to get bad around the sides. It is believed if it molded this poorly in 1755, the soldier using it wouldn't have been too pleased. The reason is, the most time-consuming part of musket ball molding is filing down and cutting off the excess lead. It can't get up by itself, can it? Now, are there any questions about musket ball molding or anything else you've seen here on the tour of the fort? If there are no questions, I have two announcements to make before concluding the tour. First announcement is that if you missed the first part of this tour and like to see it in its entirety, next one will be starting on the hour right here in the audiovisual chamber. Second announcement is that it's Fort College to hand out free musket balls to all the children. Very serious warning about these musket balls, though. Please listen to this warning. These are pure lead. Lead is a toxic substance and a brain poison. For no reason whatsoever, put these in their mouth. Very good idea to wash your hands after handling them and before eating. Parents, if you're concerned about young children, collect them, coat them in clear nail polish, and you'll seal in the lead. I still wouldn't suggest putting them in my mouth, though, because who knows with clear nail polish. Now I've made them sound oh so tempting, if you still like a free musket ball, just come up to the stage, I'll be handing them out.
CJ. There's clothing and stuff up there.
Clay marbles, look.
What's that?
Look.
Bumping me, please.
Get over here. Jesus. Whoa. Have everything. You can walk over here. Ooh, prince. Hey. Look down. Right there. Wooden bottle.
Yep.